glad you are here. We would invite you to register your attendance on the registration pads that are on the inside pew aisle and pass them along to the outside aisle so that we might have a record of everyone's attendance this morning. We now invite you to stand together and join in our call to worship, number 364, Because He Lives. So that we might truly bring glory to you in what we do this hour. Father, we also come before you with hearts that are filled with joy for the blessings that you give us, and hearts that are heavy with concern for all of those that touch our lives in such meaningful ways, and we know that they are going through times of difficulty, through illness, through places in life where we just need your touch. We ask, Lord, now that you hear the prayers of your people.
Our military personnel.
Jackie Boyan and his dad.
Roosevelt Hart,
Karen Bowles,
Swell.
Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Father, we are blessed by all of these that you have placed around us. Help us always to see each person that we come to know to be a gift from you. Some of these souls, Lord, we know are wrapped in bright colored paper, others in plain paper. Some are large, some are small, but they are all gifts from you. And we ask your blessings upon all of those that we've lifted up, those that are on our prayer list, and those that remain unsaid but are ever much on our hearts. We ask your blessings. We ask that you be the great physician that reaches out and touches, heals, and blesses in a mighty and powerful way. We ask all these things in the name of Jesus Christ our Lord, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. We invite you now to stand and join in our praise chorus for the month. It is printed in your bulletin. It is also up on the screen. Here I am to worship. Father, we are grateful for the gifts that you bless us with, for the love that you pour out upon us, and for what we bring back to you. Father, help us always to know that all we have belongs to you. If you ask of us a small part, help us to bring back what is yours. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. You may be seated.
And would the children come forward at this time and join? This is the children's time. With her fine hat.
Good morning. Y'all like my hat? It's beautiful. Well, thank you. I want to talk to y'all about fishing today, about fishing for people. So I'm going to read to you from Matthew 4:18. Now Jesus, walking by the Sea of Galilee, saw two brothers, Simon called Peter and Andrew, his brother, casting a net into the sea, for they were fishermen. And he said to them, "Follow me, and I will make you fishers of men." Do you know what that means? You think that means like, you know, casting a net out and pulling in a human? Think? No? No. We're talking about calling people to Christ, about teaching people about God's word. So, have y'all fished before? You like fishing? Are you good at it? You catch a lot of fish? No, you don't? I don't like fishing because I have no patience. I wish you could just cast it out there and you get a fish and you reel it in. But I get bored sitting and being patient. And I don't really know how to fish that well, and I don't like touching the worms. They're goopy. But I have my own worms right here, and they're pretty delicious. You want more?
Yes.
Yeah? So I want to talk about what makes us good fishermen. Do you think you need a certain kind of bait? You use hot dogs. Do you get a lot of fish that way? You do? I'm going to try that. My gosh. And corn. I've never heard of that before. Well, to be a good fisherman, we need certain equipment. And we need a good kind of bait. We need to be patient. And it's the same thing with calling people to Christ. The more we know about God's word and the more we live it, the more equipped we are to call people to Christ. And that's pretty cool, right? So, I'm going to put my word down. And bow your heads with me so we can pray. Oh, glorious God, make me a caster of your light, a light that shines so bright that my love and devotion to you and your works shines through me and reels in all to seek your word. Amen. Y'all ready to ring the bell? Let's ring the bell.
Once for Father God, once for Jesus our Savior, and once for the Holy Spirit.
scripture lesson is taken from Matthew, the 4th chapter, 18 through the 26 verses. You hear the word of God. And as Jesus walked alongside the Galilee Sea, he saw two brothers, Simon, who is called Peter, and Andrew, throwing fishing nets into the sea because they were fishermen. "Come, follow me," he said, "and I'll show you how to fish for people." And right away, they left their nets and followed him. Continuing on, he saw another set of brothers, James, the son of Zebedee, and his brother John. And they were in a boat with Zebedee, their father, repairing their nets. And Jesus called them. And immediately they left the boat and their father and followed him. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Share one other passage of scripture with you as we begin this morning from the book of Hebrews, chapter 12, verses 1 and 2. "So then, let's also run the race that is laid out in front of us. Since we have such a great cloud of witnesses surrounding us, let's throw off any extra baggage, get rid of the sin that tripped us up, and fix our eyes on Jesus, faith's pioneer and perfecter. He endured the cross, ignoring the shame, for the sake of the joy that was laid out in front of him, and sat down at the right side of God's throne." Again, the word of God for the people of God. Let us pray. Father, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, for you are our strength and our redeemer. Joe Garagiola, the late Joe Garagiola, who some of you might remember from his baseball playing days. I know he played for the Pittsburgh Pirates, and I don't remember who else. But I don't remember him as a baseball player. I remember him as a baseball commentator and used to call the game of the week every week on television. And as a kid, I got to be pretty familiar with him. Well, Garagiola, when he was a player, was a catcher. And it was at the same time that Stan Musial, the late Hall of Fame baseball player, was playing for the St. Louis Cardinals, and Pittsburgh and St. Louis were playing a critical game together. And Garagiola was catching, and when Musial came to bat at a particular point in the game, pitchers just dreaded facing this guy when he was in his prime. And the Musial steps into the batter's box, and Garagiola puts his hand down between his legs, as catchers do when they're signaling the pitcher what to throw, and he called for a fastball. And the pitcher shook his head no. So then he called for a curveball. The pitcher shook him off again. And so then he signaled for the pitcher's specialty pitch. He didn't say what it was, but signaled for that, and the pitcher shook him off a third time. So Garagiola gets up out of his crouch and goes out to have a conference on the pitcher's mound, as they often do in baseball, that tends to make games really long. And so he goes out there and he said, "I've called for everything you throw. What do you want to throw?" The pitcher said, "Nothing." He said, "I want to stand here and hold this ball as long as I can." He was young, he was nervous, and Musial scared him to death, to the point he couldn't even get the at-bat started. We're a lot like that. Sometimes we get so afraid of what might happen to us that we get scared, that we don't want to get started with whatever it is. I know that you have probably watched an Olympic race, a track race, and when they first get ready and all the runners go out there and they're standing behind the starting blocks, and some of them are clowning around with each other, some of them are jumping up and down trying to stretch or do whatever they can to keep their muscles loose. Some of them are just laser focused on what's ahead of them. And then the starter will call and will say, "Runners, take your marks." Now, kids always say, "On your mark," before they have a race. But usually in track meets, they'll say, "Runners, take your mark." And we're going to talk more about all of the other parts of that in the next 2 weeks. Today, we are starting a new 3-week sermon series that I'm calling The Race. And it's, this week is On Your Mark, next week will be Get Set, and the third week's going to be Go. And in this series, we're going to talk about what those can mean as we run the race of Christian faith. God is calling us to our places. God is calling us to get ready. And when the starter tells the runners, "Runners, take your mark," all that clowning around and jumping up and down, and now there still may be some stretching that goes on, but it all stops. And the runners become quiet. Even those that weren't focusing already focus on the race. They walk up into the starting blocks. They get their feet in, they get their hands behind the starting line, and they're ready. And my question for you this morning is, are we ready? God has already said to us, just as Jesus said to the disciples, "Come and follow me." That's the same thing is that starter saying, "Runners, take your marks." Jesus is saying to us, take your marks. On your mark. Get ready. It's coming. Take your marks. Get yourself focused. Now, this analogy of the race not only is in what I read there from Hebrews 2, which will be our theme passage for this series, but in 2 Timothy, Paul says, "I have fought the good fight, I have finished the race, I have kept the faith." Paul is saying that the life in faith is like a race. Now, races can be varying distances. But for most of us, the race that we run now is a greater, harder, longer race than the longest race anybody ever runs. Now, some people think that's a marathon. If you've ever seen that sticker on the back of somebody's car that says 26.2, that means they ran a marathon. If it says 13.1, they ran a half marathon. But there are people who do crazy, I mean, that's crazy enough for me, either one of them. It's obvious when you look at me, I haven't run very many races. But it's crazy enough to think about running a half marathon or a full marathon, but there are people that run 50 and 100 mile races. That's absolutely nuts. I mean, marathon runners talk about hitting the wall at about mile 21 out of 26.2. How do you run past that wall knowing you've got over 75 miles to go? That's just crazy. But this race that God calls us to is not crazy. On your mark. It's another way that the starter, or in our case, God, may have of saying, "Can I have your attention, please? Hey, it's time to focus. It's time to bring at hand the things that God calls on us to do." In the context of the church, Matthew and the lesson we actually heard twice this morning. I'm glad Jeffrey used the same one that Paul read to you too, because maybe you'll remember it this week. I know you remember everything I say, and but we have a call that God has made on our lives. Jesus comes up to Andrew and Simon Peter, if you will, comes up to them and he says, come and follow me. Come. Now, he's saying, can I have your attention for a minute? Come and follow me. Get ready. It's coming. It's a call to discipleship. It's a call to the life and faith of Jesus Christ. And make no mistake, every one of us has a call. You have a calling, I have a calling, and anybody that thinks the preacher's the only one that gets called, you're absolutely wrong. Jesus says to Simon and Andrew, and then James and John, on your mark. The race is about to begin. We switch that from being a literal race, we switch it to being more of a spiritual race. When Jesus calls these four, Scripture tells us that Simon and Andrew left their nets and followed him. And that James and John left their boat, left their father, and followed him. This morning I asked the confirmation class before we really got started, I asked them, is there anyone that you would follow, no questions asked? Well, I think because Geneva was the first one that said it, they took the easy way out at first. I didn't let them off that easy, but they said, well, the Lord. Yeah, I mean, we're at church. I mean, what else are you going to say? But then I said, is there a person that you would follow, no questions asked? Ava said her grandma. That's a really good answer, Ava. And I asked the two adults in the room as well, and your sister-in-law, Geneva said her sister-in-law, and Marty said her husband. I don't remember what Skylar and... Oh, they said that they would follow their mom. Hey, and then I asked them, again about if somebody that they didn't know, if there was somebody that they would follow, no questions asked, and it was pretty much the consensus of the room, no. And that's not a bad thing, because we teach our kids not to trust strangers. But Andrew and Simon and James and John followed someone they didn't know. They dropped what they had. And so then I asked the kids, what would you leave behind? Somebody said food. The disciples still ate after Jesus called. But what would you leave behind? I mean, and I ask you the same question. I mean, it's rhetorical now, but what is there somebody that you would follow, no questions asked, and if you did, what would you leave behind? It's not an easy question to answer. Because if that person actually was Jesus, we could be leaving all of it behind. Hey, those four guys left behind not only their stuff, their nets and their boats, but they left behind family. They left behind everything they had to follow Jesus. Are we that committed? Most of us aren't willing to give up much of anything. And I put myself in that right along with everybody else. I don't want to give up my guitars. Y'all, most of y'all know my relationship with guitars, so that's all I'm going to say about it. But these guys followed Jesus, no questions asked. And you know, I said it's not a bad thing, and that we teach our kids not to relate with strangers too much, and it's for good reason, it's dangerous. But it also spills over into adulthood. I mean, do you trust just anybody you walk up and you see in the grocery store? Most of us don't. But we are still called to be people of faith and to be about the work of God in the world. The first disciples went and followed a stranger, no questions asked. On your mark, our call to discipleship. Ignoring the call is a response. And I fear that it's something that most people of faith do because they don't know what it is that God's calling them to do. But I want to submit to you that each of us has a calling on our lives, and each of us, there's something we're supposed to be doing. And Paul and Emma and I were all called to pastoral ministry, sometimes called representative ministry. Professional ministry. But if you think that the only people who are called are people who are in representative or professional ministry, you're wrong. Some of you, and I'm thinking about Tim, and I'm thinking about Frank, and I'm thinking about Cindy, are called to be Sunday school teachers. And praise God you do that. And then some of you, Marty, Casey, I know Casey's not in here right now, I'll have to tell her I talked about her in my sermon tomorrow, are called to administration. Where would we be without somebody that looked over this administrative stuff that Keith is horrible at? I have my gifts, that's not one of them. I can do it, but it doesn't mean I have to like it. And it takes me more time than it takes either of them. Wait till next time when Marty gets sick and I have to do the bulletins. You'll see what I mean. They're called to that ministry. I mean, some of you are called to be up here on a Saturday to help take care of this place. Some of you are called sometimes to come up here because an air conditioner's broken and it had nothing to do with Saturday. Some of you are called to cook a meal when somebody's lost a friend or a family member, or they're sick themselves. All of these things are callings that God places on our lives. And as a whole, I think we do them pretty well. But I also think that there are more things that God calls us to do and calls us to be about than just the things we already do. I mean, we don't lose, praise God, we don't lose those family members or friends all the time, so it's not necessary to cook those meals all the time. But there are other things you can do. There are other ways that you can serve God and live out a call to faith. When Paul and I entered the ministry, I don't know if it was the case when Emma entered or not. We've never talked about it, but I know when he went through. It was about the same time that I did. And there was a book that we had to read and we were questioned about called The Christian as Minister. In my opinion, the book was okay at best, except for one part. And they've taken it out of the book now in later revisions. But this part of the book said, it talked about vocation, and it said your vocation is not necessarily the way that you earn your living. Your vocation is the way that you serve God. And it went on to say of how to find your vocation, you find the intersection of what most needs to be done in the world and the thing that brings you the most joy. It said that if you write commercials for television and you spend all your time writing TV deodorant commercials and you love what you do, well, you're meeting half of that. And some might argue you're meeting the whole thing because, I mean, we do need deodorant. But is it really the thing God most needs done in the world? Then it said, on the other hand, if you are a doctor and you're working in a leper colony, and your work depresses you and you find it distasteful, that you may be meeting that thing of what God most needs done in the world, but you're not meeting the thing that brings you joy, and you're probably not doing your patients much good either. We need to find that place in our lives where we go from the thing that brings us joy, where it meets up with what God needs done in the world. On your mark. NASCAR's Jeff Gordon. He doesn't drive anymore, but he's a NASCAR commentator. And a pretty famous driver was in attendance at the Billy Graham Crusade in Indianapolis, one of Graham's last crusades. And towards the end of the night, Graham called Gordon up onto the stage. And Gordon gave his testimony. And when he came out, and it was just wild reception for this NASCAR driver. And Gordon said, driving a race car is only a small portion of who I am, because who I really am is a disciple of Jesus Christ. Now, I can't say what Gordon does as a disciple. I have no idea. Don't know the man personally. And on television, they just talk about his racing. But I do know he's got the right idea, because he hears on your mark. Well, he hears it a little different. Drivers, start your engines. But he knows that what he does on a racetrack takes a huge back seat, pun intended, to what he does for God. What we do for a living may or may not be our call. And you know, as I think about it, teachers, not Sunday school teachers. Being a teacher, particularly in the public school system, is a calling all into itself. And if anybody doesn't think it is, go talk to a teacher. Because they're called by God to do the things that they do. Find that place where God calls you. We live in a hurting, broken world, a world that's called to the race, to the life and faith, a world that's called for everyone to be disciples of Jesus Christ. The question for us is, will we as the church work to bridge the gaps in the world, or will we work to widen those gaps? Friends, we need to be bridge builders, and we need to get over it. God calls us. We need to trust in God. God calls us to love one another, and God calls us to be bridge builders. On your mark, the race starter says, Jesus is trying to get our attention. It's time to get up to the line, to get into the starting blocks. It's time for the race. Racers, take your mark. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Would you please turn to 885 in the back of your hymnal? your church, apostolic and universal, whose holy faith let us now declare.
Please rise.
We believe in God the Father, infinite in wisdom, power, and love, whose mercy is over all his works, and whose will is ever directed to his children's good. We believe in Jesus Christ, Son of God and Son of Man, the gift of the Father's unfailing grace, the ground of our hope, and the promise of our deliverance from sin and death. We believe in the Holy Spirit as the divine presence in our lives, whereby we are kept in perpetual remembrance of the truth of Christ, and find strength and help in time of need. We believe this faith manifests itself in the service of love, and set forth in the example of our blessed Lord, to the end that the kingdom of God may come upon the earth.
Amen. Our closing hymn this morning is it's in your bulletin, it's not a number. I have decided to follow Jesus. With the singing of this hymn, we open the doors of our church to accept members in any way they might come, by profession of faith, baptism, or by transfer of letter from another Methodist church or another denomination. Let us stand together to sing number 2129, which you don't have those numbers, but up on the screen or in your bulletin, I have decided to follow Jesus.